God doesn't say that, does he? Verse 10, he says, we are God's workmanship. You are my workmanship. You are my masterpiece. And through that masterpiece, God's glory shines. Now, why do I say this? Because some of you might sit there and say, no, I don't fall into that way world of thinking. But do you read the magazines? Do you look at the TV? Do you watch the advertisements? It's insidious. It gets into your thinking.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Lord, Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for your written word. We thank you, Lord, how it speaks to us about who you are and about who we are. Lord, just want to praise you. Lord, we just ask for your spirit as it is present with us, that, Lord, that you continue to impart the knowledge, the life-changing knowledge, Lord, that we need to hear. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, this morning, it's been a very interesting morning so far. Let's start. I want us to discuss this morning a very, very small subject. Creation. Small, isn't it? So we're going to look at creation this morning. Okay? So if you could grab your Bibles, please, and turn to the easiest page to find, Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, beginning in the Bibles, should be page 3, apparently, if you have a red Bible. So, we're going to read the whole of this, or I'm going to read, you're going to read along with me, the whole of this chapter. And whilst we're doing that, we're going to have a nice little slideshow going on in the background. So, everybody ready? Everybody ready?
Yes, Uncle Warren.
Thank you. I'm still the right side of 40, though, by the way, Richard. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water." So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let the dry ground appear." And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then the Lord said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living and moving thing with which the waters teemed, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful, increase in number, and fill the water in the seas. And let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. And let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. There will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their various array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing, and so the seventh day he rested from all his work. That is creation's story, the story of creation. Did you like the pictures, by the way? Let's thank National Geographic, Hubble Telescope, and everybody else. They were brilliant. And to me, as I was looking at those pictures and I was reading them, reading this chapter, it just brings it more to life. It just sees the way that God created. And I think sometimes with Genesis chapter 1 and slightly into 2, we sort of avoid reading that and seeing creation coming into being. It's not scientific as we understand it. The Bible was never meant to be a scientific book. So I don't want to discuss creation theory, evolution. That's not what we're here for. What I'm here to see is to watch our Creator create the very world that we live in. Yes? Our Creator God be an artist. Be an artist. There's something I really, there's an image I love. I've just, joy has forced me recently to read the Chronicles of Narnia. I do say the word force because it was true. C.S. Lewis had a fantastic moment in the book The Magician's Nephew, where he sees Aslan. Do you know Chronicles of Narnia? Aslan, meant to be, you know, most people regard as a depiction of Jesus, or definitely of creating. And him singing this land into being. And if you read the account, it's wonderful. It is a beautiful account. It really is. And I just, my mind just expanded this concept, this word of song coming out, trees growing, creatures being formed, and land and the sky. It's beautiful. Please, I suggest you read it if you've not read it. It's beautiful. It really helps bring, to me, Genesis into sort of a different way of looking. Because we say that the world and the universe was created by the very word of God, yes? Maybe God sung it, as we would understand, into being. It would have been more in tune than I would have been ever singing. But he brought it in. And God created this universe out of nothing. Out of nothing. God is not created, he is the creator. And he is, I've got to say, an artist. A much better artist than any other artist that ever existed on this planet. Yes? But he's an artist. It is beautiful. If you look at the creation, if you look at the grass, if you look at a plant, if you look at a tree, look at the stars, they are beautiful. Yes? And that's the God that we worship. I really want us to get this expanse of how beautiful things are. We probably don't really... That's why I had to put the pictures up, because this building, I'm not being... But it does limit what we can see with our eyes at the moment. But God created. And also God created man and woman in his own image. So we're part of that creation. We look at that on the sixth day, as in the account here of Genesis, that we were created. So we're part of God's artistry. You might find this morning that, you know, some of the pictorial stuff I'm going to be discussing is a bit, you know, sort of out there. But, you know, God's out there. We don't have all this wonderful array of colours and different kinds of animals and creatures. If it wasn't for the fact, I would say our God was an artist. I hope you agree. Part of this word creation, I just want to go that where in verse 1 it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. That word created, the where created is used currently, the Hebrew word for that, is later on used elsewhere. And I just want us to note this just for a moment, is elsewhere in the Bible, used in the context of salvation. If you didn't know that, I just want you to bear that in mind. So this word create that we see in this account, it is later on used elsewhere, mainly in the Old Testament, is salvation. And I just want us to note that. So anyway, God created this wonderful universe and us, and it was very good. Yes? Stood back and he said, look at that. I made that and I'm very pleased. That's very good. What happened? What happened after that? It was very good. And Andy, I would sneak out via my office if I was you, my brother. I think you, both male and female, the fall occurred. Okay, allow me to cover that. Thank you, Andy. Unfortunately, yes, we get the account that sin then came into the world. Well, let's be honest, by us. We might sit there and say we were deceived, but ultimately we was off. God made a simple rule. Don't touch the fruit of that tree. Don't do it. And as like most humans, we tend to go, oh, yeah. Let me touch the fruit of that tree. If we're told not to do it. I know with Keris, when we tell her not to do something, guaranteed she'll want to do it. The fall occurred. Creation, the very good creation that God created, suddenly started not to fall to pieces, but bad things started to happen to it. It was not the way that God's created it. But still, our God created. Still, the artist created this beautiful world universe that we live in. And I just want us to understand that. So, we're living as fallen people. The world doesn't look very good. Did God leave it alone? No, still very much present and working it. Could you turn with me to Colossians chapter 1? You don't need to keep a finger in Genesis. We're not going back there. Colossians chapter 1. It is page 1182 if you have a red Bible. I'm sorry, in the larger print again, I apologise, I don't know. Chapter 1. We're going to go on definitely a few years from Genesis. we're going to go on to this moment where this fallen world, this perfect world that God had created, is now full of sin, man and woman rising up against each other. Notice it's man and woman rising up against each other. And you know, we're not in a good place. And we're walking in not a very good way. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. God needed to do something about it. His creation, his whole creation, was descending towards destruction. He, that is Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. He might have the supremacy. That's Jesus. That's Jesus, as we all know, came, died on the cross, and rose again. Yes, for our sins. And he was the very image of the invisible God. But I love this verse 16. For by him all things were created. So Jesus was there, we know, at the beginning of creation, yes? And it was by him that all this beauty and wonder that we just read about, this artistry, was created through and by Jesus. Yes? By our God. Who, to save his fallen creation, said, I'm going to come down and reconcile it. I'm going to bring it back to where it is. I'm going to reconcile it by coming down, dying on the cross, and rising again. Yes? Let's capture this just for a moment. This God who created this beautiful universe, this beautiful land, wanted to die for us because he loved us so, came down. Do we capture that in our daily lives? Do you capture that in your daily life? I don't. I look at all the wonder of the stars and trees and seas and land, and I think, God, gee, it's beautiful. And God says, yes, it is beautiful. But I needed to reconcile the whole of creation, so I had to come down, die on a cross for you. I had to go through immense pain and suffering, be rejected, to reconcile this beautiful creation that I sung into beginning, I'm sorry, I'm going to use that I sung into beginning in beautiful song. I had to come down from my throne to bring it back to me through my son, to bring us back to him through his son, who all things are created by. And he holds all things together. Do we capture the heart of our Father through that? You can nod, you can respond, you can shake your head. But do we capture that? Do you spend enough time looking at the creation that's around you? Yes? No, we don't, do we? To use a phrase that was used yesterday that I really liked, a lot of us are like headless chicken Marthas. We're running around being busy, we don't stop enough to look at what God has created and to actually marvel at it, and then therefore will help us marvel at why Jesus came down. But why did he do it? I know we say that he loves us, but Question is, why didn't he do what he did in Noah's time? That's my question. Why didn't he just wipe out the population and start again? But the fall already happened. It came through fallen people. So again, he was re-expanding. But instead of this time wiping out, he says, no, I am going to show my love. I'm going to show my love to my creation by sending my son down. But why? That just still blows my mind to this day, that he loves us that much. But let's look at, see if we can look at why. Can you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2? Ephesians chapter 2, it's a few pages back, it's page 1174. This is Paul writing to the church at Ephesus, but this is so much will be written to us as well. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And these are the few verses I want us to note. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, yes, last week, and recently, it seems to be that for some reason, the sort of style of sermons I seem to be thinking that God wants to convey is it's by faith and not by works. It is by grace and not by works that we are here. Now, I don't know why that is. Is it I'm not getting it? Or is it we are not getting it? But why is it by grace? Why is it by God's love that we are here? Why is it that Jesus came down? Well, I think in verse 10, that's what finally exploded it for me. For we are God's, what does it say? Workmanship. And again, we are God's workmanship. Now, I prefer, and I can't believe I'm going to say this, but I prefer the New Living Translation version of this. It says, for we are God's masterpiece. I don't know if that for you goes, wow. For me, that goes well. If you're an engineer, a builder, or somebody who's practical with their hands, I reckon probably for you, workmanship works better. If you're sort of very, what I would like to consider me likes creative things and being, yes, Joy, just like you, dear, but who likes being creation and stuff, probably masterpiece works better for you as a word. Whatever the word is, we're God's masterpiece. Now, I know that this was written, Ephesians was written to the church to say that it's God's masterpiece. But seeing that church is made up of individuals, we're therefore then God's masterpieces of individuals. Yes? You can say amen if you wish.
Amen.
If you wish, thanks. But we are God's masterpiece. Question I want to ask. If we are God's masterpiece, and Christ was what was to be human. What dehumanizes us? I need to run all the way over here. What? Because God created, we saw right at Genesis, right at the beginning in day six, in his own image. But I don't know about you, there seems to be a message all of this morning from what John was saying and from the songs that we were singing about us being God's masterpiece. But what stops us thinking like, the word that kept going through me, what dehumanizes us? What reduces us from that? Anyone got any answers to that? Fiona. Shoot all the way to the back.
I think it's listening to the world. It's listening to the world, listening to people's opinion on us, and not hearing what God's saying about us, but listening to what other people are saying and other influences that aren't right for us.
Okay. Listening to what the world says about us. Yeah, absolutely. Anybody else? Mark.
We listen to the doubt in our mind and undervaluing exactly what we are in the world and what we are to God.
Okay. Undervaluing. We undervalue ourselves in listening to our own minds, yeah? Anybody else? Tony first, and then Anna.
Well, people have different faiths. They actually don't believe in Jesus.
Okay, so different faiths. Those of not Jesus dehumanizes, yeah?
No, we are a showcase for Jesus, so we need to reflect him.
Okay. So we need to reflect him because we're the showcase, but we don't do that often. Okay. What dehumanizes us? One of the things that got me was we do, especially in our world, we listen to what the world says. We listen to what the world says we should be like. We listen to the world says what we should have. I'm not knocking these people, but you know, it says you're meant to have the perfect body. You're meant to have the perfect looks. You're meant to have the perfect car, like a Mercedes. Yes, Timmy? I couldn't resist. I had to pick that one out. It's not at all. No pick on Timmy at all. But you know, the world says you're meant to have certain education. You are meant to look a certain way. You're meant to have a certain job, certain amount of money in the bank. You're meant to know certain things. You know, that's what the world says that we should be like, to be accepted, perfect, and the right masterpiece. Yes? Stop that now. Do you know something? It was incredibly hard for me during the week. I was trying to find those pictures and trying to find some pictures. And I was struggling to find what I would consider to be decent pictures to give an example of what the world says. So I put in advertising. I did it in the web search under moderate web search. I wanted to make sure that it didn't come up wrong. And I put in, and I'm not knocking these stores, but I put in Marks and Spencers and Debenhams. I wanted to see some models in nice clothing. Do you know what that came up? Women in bikinis and in underwear, you know, these what they consider to be fantastically shaped bodies and everything else, which are clearly airbrushed, by the way. But that's all that came up. And I thought, okay. Andy was with me in the office and he said, tap in beauty. Make sure it's a safe mode search, but tap in beauty. Did that. Again, same imagery came up. And men came up this time as well, and with all these beautiful, hunky bodies, and turned that off quickly. But that's the imagery that came up. It was very hard to find just a simple headshot. And that's what the world sees as beautiful, is you've got to have a particular physique. That's what makes you beautiful. God doesn't say that, does he? Verse 10, he says, we are God's workmanship. You are my workmanship. You are my masterpiece. And through that masterpiece, God's glory shines. Now, why do I say this? Because some of you might sit there and say, No, I don't fall into that way world of thinking. But do you read the magazines? Do you look at the TV? Do you watch the advertisements? It's insidious. It gets into your thinking. It does, I'm sorry, it does, doesn't it? If you sit there, you think, no, it doesn't. No, I'm a Christian, I'm all right, I go by the word of God. It doesn't. We're exposed to it day in, day out, bus stops, on the radio. And it's insidious, and it does get into us. The way we dress, maybe. The style of clothes that we want to wear. To make ourselves look good. To feel good. Now, I'm not saying anything wrong with that as such. You know, it's not really worth buying, you know, a set of clothing that's like twice your size and wearing it, or a set of clothing that's half your size and wearing it. It's not particularly comfortable in any way, shape or form. But the fact that we do it because we want to make our outer image look really good so I feel good inside, God is saying, no, don't. You are my workmanship. I don't need you to do that. My artistry is in you. In you. My glory is in you. How often do you look in the mirror and think, don't like the way I look this morning? I look like that most mornings, but that's another subject. I have to go swimming first to actually help myself look better. But how often, seriously, do you look in the mirror and look at some of the blemishes and whatever? And by the way, before any bloke sits there and says, oh, this must be the women he's talking to. No, it's not. Yeah? Come on, guys, let's be honest. Yeah, how many of us look there and not happy? Why do we do that? Why do we think that it's our outward look that's important? I talk to myself as much as anyone else. Joy will vouch for this 100%, and so will some friends in here who know full well. But we do, but God says, no, don't, please. I don't look on the outside, I look on the inside. And what I created, what the masterpiece that's in you, has got the glory of the Lord shining through it. That masterpiece. Really, God wants to talk and tell people this morning, stop looking at what the world says about you and look at what I say about you. You are my masterpiece. It's the only way I can keep saying it. It just keeps buzzing around. You are my masterpiece. And I think that's evident this morning. From what John was saying this morning in the prophecy he delivered, that was the word from God about the inexpressible glory and how we don't realise that and we don't let that shine out because we're too worried about what's going on. Too worried about what people think externally about me. And also, as I like that, what John, I can't remember fully, but what John was saying is absolutely right. God says to you, you are my masterpiece. How many of you go, yeah, but what about all these defects? What about this that's wrong with me? Not externally, but internally. This sin that's in my life, the way that I think. Do you think like, you know, the way that I think about wrong people or the way that I think incorrectly about someone? I've got so much wrong with me, God. There is no way I am your masterpiece. There are some of us here that say that, are saying it now as I am talking. God is saying, you are my masterpiece. You are my masterpiece to be admired because of my glory in you. You're to be admired because you are mine and you're in Christ Jesus and you are mine. Therefore, you are to be admired because of me. this artist God who created this whole universe for a reason, this tapestry, this glorious tapestry of creation, says you're part of that tapestry and you're a masterpiece in it. I don't know if you've ever seen large tapestries of wonderful artwork, massive mosaics of pictures and different colours and different makes up. Isn't it beautiful when you step back from it and look at it? And yet when you go in further and further to it, you see more. You see the more detail that's there. And we're part of that detail. We're part of that masterpiece. To be admired. I would like you all, please, to actually look at somebody next to you and say to them, and I want no humour in this, because this is a true word that you're about to say to someone, that you are God's masterpiece. I want no humour, I want no laughter. This is something I want us to all take seriously. There is something serious God is trying to say, has been trying to say all morning this morning. I want you to look at somebody, whoever wants to go first, but I want you to repeat to each other, you are God's masterpiece. And I want you to sincerely bear in mind what you are about to say to someone. If you'd like to do that, please. Right, how many people in their mind put a but? They were saying to the other person, as the person was saying it to them, they were going, yeah, but. No, everybody accepted that quite readily. Not everyone. There is no yeah, but. You are God's masterpiece. Amen. Thank you, Joseph. You are God's masterpiece. We are God's masterpiece. Amen. And we are to be admired. Not because of what we've done. Not by our works. Let's go back to that. Let's not inflate our heads too large. Not because of our works, but because of the grace of God. But we need to accept that and run with that, because there is a therefore. If I'm God's masterpiece, therefore my life should be lived like this. My outlook should be something different from what it is now. That whole word to do with workmanship, I want to go back to that. The Greek in that is for recreation as well. It's about being recreated, and we are all being recreated. Our artist God is always touching things up. So you might have your, yeah, but there's this wrong with me. But God is doing recreation in you. He's renewing. He keeps his masterpiece going, keeps it clean, keeps it from being tarnished. That's why Jesus died on the cross, so we don't look tarnished in front of God. But that's an ongoing process. I'm sure great artists of our world, when they created their masterpieces, must have kept going back to it and adjusting something, yeah? And we're able to go to God, the artist, and say, there is a bit of something wrong with me. But God will say, fine, you're still my masterpiece, and I'll correct it, if you'll let me. To be admired. The masterpiece, the Mona Lisa. Designed by Da Vinci, yes? Painted by Da Vinci. It's there in the Louvre in Paris. It's there on display in a well-tempered room, temperature in the right room. It's to keep it as perfect as it can be. I know this because I've been there, I've seen it, only last year. And it is being admired at different angles by everybody. It was quite interesting. It was a real rush to see it. You know, there was a point where I was like, oh, I can't actually see it yet, love. Actually, it was a lot smaller than I expected, I must admit. Anyway, but I couldn't quite see it properly. There was a rush to go and see it. People wanted to see this beautiful masterpiece, this beautiful supposed smile and everything else. Everyone was looking at it at different angles. People look at us at different angles when they see the glory of God being expressed out. And it was apparently a really beautiful painting. We are a beautiful painting because God made us so. And we need to live our lives under that understanding. I'm sorry I'm banging on about constantly that we are this beautiful masterpiece, but God, I think, is trying to get something into us. Instead of getting this world's insidious message about how we should look, he's trying to say, you are my masterpiece. I created you. I put my glory in you. The very thing that created the heaven and the earth created you. Understand how beautiful you are. Please. God is imploring. Understand how beautiful you are. It is not done by makeup. It's not done by the clothes that you wear. It is because of my creation within you. Are we starting to get it? Why though? Always comes back to the question, why are we his masterpiece? And it carries on in verse 10. Created in Christ Jesus to do good works. To do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. We are created these masterpieces in this fantastic tapestry of God's creation to do good works. To show his inexpressible glory to those all around us. To let it shine. As John was saying in that, in the word he delivered earlier on, it was to do with the fact that, you know, it's look around, the glory of the Lord is here. It's through us and amongst us. And the people out there who don't know him yet need to see that. And they'll see that when we accept the fact that we are God's masterpiece, recreated in Christ Jesus. But we need to accept that. And that therefore that I was talking about earlier is that therefore. Because we are created as this masterpiece to do good works. But the good works is just to show Christ's love and to show God's glory. But it means we're going to look different from the world. Yes, we're going to have a different glow about us. I love this quote when I was doing some reading. This is a quote in a book called The Drama of Scripture. If you ever get the chance to pick it up, it is a brilliant book. The most glorious quality of humankind is that we are made in the Creator's own image, reflecting in miniature his inexpressible glory. I'll repeat that again. The most glorious quality of humankind is that we are made in the Creator's own image, reflecting in miniature his inexpressible glory. That's us. In anyone that's in Christ Jesus. We come from literally here of Genesis, down to us here, but back out again. Because it's not just about us, it's about the whole of creation. It's about the whole of God's universe. It's about the whole of the heavens and the earth. But we are his masterpiece. I would now like you to turn again to the person next to you and say that same thing again. You are God's masterpiece. So how's that going to change your thinking about the way, and how's that going to change your life? Knowing you're God's masterpiece, how's that going to change your life? Looking outwards and moving on. I'll grab a microphone while you think that through. How's that going to change? How should that change? Oh, sorry.
By loving one another. Giving love to one another.
By loving one another. It's true, actually. That's one of the things that I felt. When you look at each other, you realise that everybody else is God's masterpiece. Should mean we should not always be looking at what's wrong. Should we be looking at what's right? Being tolerant of what's wrong, sometimes correcting, there's nothing wrong with that, but actually making sure it's done with love and for the right reasons. Anybody else?
Because we're thankful and grateful to God for basically being his masterpiece, because he didn't have to choose us, telling others that, you know, that he also loves them and that he can also do the same in them and make them know about his love.
Thank you. Yeah, we can do the same. Rachel.
Accepting who we are and who we are physically, but also who we are in what we do and the role God has given us, and not thinking, oh, but I wish I was like that person or good at that, like that person. Just we are who we are. God's made us who we are, and he can perfect what's there, but he's not asking us to be someone different.
No, absolutely. That's one of the things about being God's masterpiece, is that we all have a different role within the tapestry, and we have to just accept and run with that. Steve.
Yeah, we are God's masterpiece for a purpose, reflecting how great he is to other people around us.
Thank you. Joan.
If we truly believe that each of us is God's masterpiece, we've got to believe that we have the gift to do what we've been asked to do by God. So we shouldn't doubt, and it should increase our amount of trust and faith in him. So when we feel that God's asked us to do something, just step out and do it, because he's already given you the gift to do it.
No, that's absolutely, that's one of the other things. We are, because we're God's masterpiece, he has given us the gifts and the talents to do things, and stop doubting it and stop saying, no, possibly not me because of what's wrong with me. God's saying, no, look at what's right with you. I've given you those talents and those gifts.
For me, when I think about God's masterpiece, if you think about holding a newborn baby that is completely perfect and you hold it in your arms and you can't help but smile, it's knowing that you're God's masterpiece and that you have to make other people smile around you while you're doing God's work, so that they're interested and they want to find out more about what's making you smile while you're doing whatever it is.
Yes, yeah, brilliant. We have got to stop, and I do say we, stop looking at the world thinks and actually realise what God thinks about us and what we're able to do, because we are his masterpiece. We're his masterpiece to do good works, to do his will, but we're still his masterpiece and he makes it capable. Just like us spend some time just reflecting on that, just for a moment, for yourself now. Joshua's just going to play Be Still. If you wouldn't mind just jumping up there now, thank you. And just for a while it's very quietly being played, I'd just like you to talk to God, just for yourself. Don't ask the question, am I your masterpiece? Because if you're in Christ Jesus, you are. Stop asking the question, just accept the fact that you are. But ask God to help you see you the way he sees you. Thank you, Joshua. The world has a false image of what we should be like. God does not have a false image of us. He has a true and right image. He knows us well, because he made us and put his glory in us for it to shine forth for everyone to see. We need to be able to wake up every morning and see the whole day through, knowing that we are created as his masterpiece to do his will and his good works, and not to sit there and think, I'm not good enough. Lord, Heavenly Father, I want to thank you. I want to thank you that, I just want to thank you for creation. I just want to thank you for your glory. I want to thank you for your artistry. I want to thank you for the beauty that you put inside each and every one of us. Lord, I ask for all of us here who have not quite grasped how much you admire and love us, not because of our works, not because of anything we've done, but because of your grace. Because of your grace. Because of your grace. Lord, I ask that you will impart to us just how much the Father smiles and looks at us. I want to pray against the image that we see within the world, Lord. I want to pray against that. I want to pray against that getting into us insidiously. And let us take our image of ourselves from the very image that you created us in the first place, the very image of God. In your name, amen. If this morning you want to be prayed for again, well, let's open up that offer that was offered at ministry time. If you wish to be prayed for, please, there are going to be a few of us here at the front. We'll pray with you, pray for you. God has spoken to you this morning.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.
This vehicle is leaving the station. Please hold on.